Led in the Pledge of Allegiance by Director Norma Galindo.
Please place your hand over your heart. Ready? Begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Kelly and Mr. Simmons, do we have any actions taken in closed session to be reported out?
Thank you, Director Desert. My name is Ross Simmons, and I've been engaged to serve as interim general counsel for the IID. The board took action in closed sessions to approve a closeout settlement agreement for engineering, procurement, and construction. It was between the IID and ARB Inc., which settles disputes regarding change orders arising from the El Centro Unit 3 repower project. The agreement was approved by all five directors. And the board also took action in closed session to approve and delegate authority to the general manager to execute an amendment to the interim funding agreement between IID and Associated Electric and Gas Insurance Services Limited, otherwise known as AGIS. The amendment will provide for insurance reimbursement of legal defense costs for the Western Farms cases. The amendment will be available to the public after it's fully executed. The board's action was on a 4-1 vote, with Director Hanks voting no.
Thank you, Mr. Simmons. At this time, would the board please join me in front of the dais for presentations for certificate of retirement, awards, and service awards.
This is a retirement certificate, and we hardly get these. They all prefer to get them at their other parties, but here we have a special one. It's for Bernice Rabb. And let me read you what the certificate says. It says, the Board of Directors, officers, and employees of Imperial Irrigation District extend to you our sincere appreciation for your 33 years of faithful, loyal, and dedicated service, your commitment to excellence in the performance of your position, which is accounts payable specialist, and your outstanding contributions to the operation of the district will remain always in our memory. It will. And may your retirement years be filled with rewarding experiences presented this day. How many days do you have left?
8 days.
You can do that standing up.
Yes, I can.
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2.
Anybody want to see
my picture? Yeah, I'm
already signed.
There's a whole thing of general accounting.
There you go.
I'm looking at a run.
Service awards. They all read the same except with the name and years of service. And this is what it reads. This certificate of recognition and service pin replica of the district emblem are presented to, and this one's presented to Gustavo Wu Wong for 20 years of loyal and faithful service to the Imperial Irrigation District. Smile. And the next one is for 25 years of service for Rodney Averett, Supervisor Generation Maintenance in the Energy Department. For 35 years of service, Charles B. Garcia Jr., San Jero in the Water Department. Now, is there anyone else here to receive a service award and I didn't call your name? Okay, that ends our service awards.
Board, this takes us into the approval of the agenda item. You've all had time to review the agenda. Any questions, discussions?
I was wondering if we can pull consent number two, the claim report, out for discussion.
So we'll pull consent item two, which is the claim report on page 10 of the agenda. And you want to handle it at the end of the consent item area, or do you want to take it to the beginning of the action area?
It's your preference.
We'll take it. We'll handle it as before we get in. It'll be the first item in action.
Okay.
Anything else, Board?
I move to accept the agenda as it is with pulling item number 2.
We have a motion.
Second the motion.
Motion from Director Galindo and a second from Director Hanks to accept the agenda as amended. That amendment is moving the item consent item 2 regarding claim reports to the action area of our agenda. Any further questions, discussion? Call for the vote. Okay, the agenda passes as amended 5-0. This moves us into the public comments part of our agenda. This is a public meeting, and this is a time for public comment. At this time, you may address the board on items that are within the subject matter jurisdiction of IID, but not an item on the agenda. Those who wish to address the board should come to the microphone and state your name and address for the record. Any action taken as a result of public comment shall be limited to direction to staff. And there's also a 3-minute limit on the public comment. Welcome, Mr. Ramos.
Good afternoon, Mr. Desert. Tony Ramos, Central Resident. Last time I was here, I felt that, and this is nothing personal, Mr. Desert, it's all about public issues. It's about your public election, nothing personal, as it is in my case. Any board members, anybody I talk about, is nothing about family, anything that you've done personally to me. It's about your public positions. And I feel that the First Amendment to the Constitution allows us to speak freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of press, freedom to gather, and then freedom to question wars like this. That's the beauty of being an American. And not because I was in the Air Force should I be treated any different, but I fought for that, for those 5 things. I didn't go to Vietnam, mind you, but I did join the Air Force from 1966 to 1970, and I would have gone to Vietnam if they would have told me. In fact, I was more scared to go to the South, South Carolina, than I was to Vietnam because of the way they were treating people like Martin Luther King here. Believe me, I saw that. And the first thing I saw was a billboard that said, "This is Ku Klux Klan country." And I didn't even understand what that was really, because I was 19, naive, until I got into it. But I knew that there was good people living there. And those people that treated me with indifference, I never treated them differently. And I fought to be not like them, but to change them and to be able to speak freely. The Brown Act also says, "The people of this state do not yield their sovereignty to the agencies they serve. The people in delegating authority do not give their public servants, as you, the right to decide what is good for them to know and what is not good for them to know. The people insist on remaining informed so that they can control over the instruments of what they created," which is the Brown Act, the fact that we're here. So I want to make it clear to you, Mr. Coons, personally, I have nothing personal against you, and whatever you do in your private life is good. That whether you help people, the way you donate your money, it's good. But I've never attacked you or said anything about you privately or personally. It's all about public. And you could say and roll your eyes or whatever, but you've done that to me too. And I'm not going into that right now. But I do believe that this man here is what we're living for. First God. But I believe in this man. I believe in Cesar Chavez. I believe in Gandhi. I believe in the First Right Amendments. And only got another 2 seconds left, but there was an article by Michael Boddy where he says that he applauds what they did here at the board. And he says, you know, central resident, but what he failed to say that he's an Ulster resident, a farmer, and part of Ivy First, whom him and his brother donated $5,000 each for the campaign to unseat the previous directors. So there's an agenda there. There's an agenda connecting this board to those people, Ivy First, and all of them are part of COLAC, they're part of Imperial Group, the Farm Bureau, the 54950 Commission, and Ivy First. All I'm saying, let me speak my piece when I come up here. Don't interrupt me, and I'll give you the same respect. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Ramos. Lindsay Dale.
Good afternoon, Lindsay Dale, Imperial County Farm Bureau. I'm going to read just a brief statement. I'm also passing along copies for yourself for your files, too. Imperial County Farm Bureau Board of Directors wishes to commend your recent decision to remove the Allen Mackin Law Firm as representation in the QSA-related litigation and your subsequent replacement of Mr. Charles Dumars. It has long been the Farm Bureau's opinion that Mr. Dumars is an excellent successor to represent the IED on water issues. Although we urge you to continue utilizing the resources of Mr. Dumars, that he has to offer in matters of water litigation, we encourage this board to seek replacements for the Allen Mackin's firm specifically suited adequately to represent IED interest in state and federal politics and as well as the entire community. The ICFB Board of Directors recognizes that decisions that you make on the QSA matters should not come lightly, and we do appreciate your timely further research and your thought into this matter. And as always, Farm Bureau is here to support your decisions and work closely with you in this matter. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lindsay. Any other public comment? Not seeing any, we'll move into board member comments this morning or this afternoon, and we'll start with Director Kuhn.
I don't know what the perception is out there. I mean, there's a lot of people that don't know me. They don't know what I do, and there are some people out there that do know, and the Abadi, Mike Abadi and Jim Abadi, they donated to my campaign as other people donated to my opponent's campaign. But the Abadi brothers, Jim and Mike, have been personal friends of mine way before I ever thought I'd be on this IID board. And I'm talking going back 20, 25 years. Hell, we were young then. Anyway, just to put this into perspective, again, I've said it here, Mike Abadi, Jim Abadi, and myself, right after that horrible 2010 earthquake, we took thousands and thousands of dollars worth of supplies down into the Mexicali Valley and distributed to six families that, because I have a home there in this little Puebla, and there's about 30 people that were horribly impacted. And we did that, and we didn't tell people we did it, but we just did it. We didn't do it for recognition. We did it because it was the right thing to do. And that carries on. You can fast forward. I've never stopped doing that. Neither has Mr. Abadi. I know during the campaign we had he and Alex and Jim put on a huge cook at the Casa de Manana building, and there must have been 500 pounds of meat left, and they wrapped that up, got it in a pickup, and got it down to an orphanage in Mexicali before God got the news. I thought that was really admirable, but they do that. That said, you know, for me to hear things bad about them, just so you know, the little girl that, and we didn't make this public either because I didn't want to use this campaign fodder, but the little girl that died in that house fire in Calexico during the campaign, Mike Abadi paid for half her funeral, and I paid for the other half because we did not want the family to be stressed. We did not want them to be burdened by the cost, and we did not ask for recognition. The only reason I'm making it public today is because I just keep hearing these horrible things that those Abadi boys do. And I don't see that in their life, and I don't see it in my life. Anyway, I've said enough.
Director Hanks.
Yeah, just would like to announce that we had our second meeting with the Imperial County on settlement talks. We realize we're up against a running clock, and we're moving as quickly as possible to reach a settlement agreement. We think it's going to be very important to all the parties in the region to get on board and seek a settlement. The key to the issue, as it was during the negotiations, the initial negotiations, is the Salton Sea and what is it going to look like, and who's going to pay. That's the bottom line. On this week, there will be 5 workshops conducted by the Water Conservation Committee. First 2 will be Wednesday at the Stockman's Club in Brawley at 9:30 a.m. and 3 o'clock. The discussions will center around the appropriation. There will be 2 meetings at the Farm Bureau on Thursday at 10 and 3. And then there will be 1 meeting Friday at Hopeville, and I believe it's the Chamber of Commerce building at 10. So if you want to get up to speed on what's happening there, please attend these meetings. Thank you.
Director Benson.
Hello and welcome everybody here today. Had a busy week last week. Many of you attended the Renewable Energy Conference. I thought it was very well attended by not just solar, but a full cross section. On Friday, there was actually a full panel discussion on geothermal and the future of potential geothermal here. Actually had Michael Picker, who is the governor's assistant on renewable energy here, speaking on Thursday night, and that was very good to get him here. And also, I believe the chairman of the CEC, that's the California Energy Commission, was here. It's just good to bring these people into our community, let them know that we're real, put a face to names, and then also have all the business partners interacting. A lot of great things came about it. I actually sat next to Jose Martin and Rick Johnson from San Diego State Center for Energy Sustainability, and Dean Pearson's here in the audience, so thank you for coming. There's a lot of great things happening to benefit the community in response to renewable energy, and we're trying to push for projects in IID's balancing authority going forward. So that point was very strongly given throughout the whole conference. Also on Saturday, attended the air show, welcomed the Blue Angels. It's the potential last air show for our Navy base here. So with sequestration, it's 1 of 2 this year in the United States, and it was great for all the people that could attend and support the Blue Angels. In response to that, I've also joined the Coalition for the Joint Strike Fighter. This is the new next generation aircraft here in Imperial County, potentially. There's 2 bases in California that are being looked at to support 7 squadrons, but it's a total of 104 aircraft. And we would be getting those potentially in the 30 or 60 days that they're fogged in up north. It's us and another base in Northern California. But there is a coalition of county, city, and IID trying to get that base located here. It would mean over 4,000 new jobs for our area. It would also mean a great expansion to the base. And with not much more impact than we have currently with a base of the kind that we do. Last Thursday, WCAB and Water Conservation Committee, Jim alluded to, we had a meeting. There was much discussion on the apportionment program and a potential date when that would start. They came up with a resolution that I don't know if it's being presented today, but with a date when that to start in the pre-summer, May 1st, I think, was a date that was thrown out. This board still needs to vote on it, and it's up for discussion going forward. But as soon as that can get pushed into being, I think it's a good thing to fall within the realm of being under on the river. Just a couple other things. My brother-in-law lives in Phoenix, and he's been reading the paper for me over there. There's a lot of issues in Arizona similar to our own. The EPA ruling that's affecting our San Juan plant is also affecting their plant. And that's the water that they pump off the Colorado River, and it's making their water more expensive. Also, Yuma is fighting with Phoenix now over water rights, and there's a potential bill being passed in the state legislature over there. So farming water is at risk in the whole farm community of the Colorado River, and we're going to do everything we can to protect farming here in our valley. Lastly, if you want to support farming, I sit on the board of the Boys and Girls Club, and this is a plug for this Friday. I have tickets to the Saladero contest. It's a produce gala finishing off the produce season. So come see me after. I'm sure you all want to buy them. Thanks.
Director Galindo.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to take this opportunity to convey my condolences to the family of Mr. Glenn Sampson. I grieve his passing, and I think we all do in one form or another. He was an invaluable asset to the Imperial Irrigation District, but also to the community up in the North End, a community that is very, very close to my heart. And with that, I will turn it over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Director. Also like to recognize the passing of a past general manager at the IID, Don Toogood. That was in the paper yesterday. I'd like to also recognize and thank the IID board, the IID agency, the administration, and the staff members that have been participating in these many meetings and discussions and the outreach that's currently going on in all these different activities. Also would like to recognize and introduce and welcome Ross Simmons this morning, sitting in as our interim general counsel. That's all for today.
President?
Yes.
I allowed myself to get a little mushy over there. I forgot to mention that I was in Yuma at the International Boundary and Water Commission Citizen Advisory Board meeting last Thursday, and Commissioner Drusina was there in person, and he gave a presentation, and I let him know that we felt that we should have perhaps a place at the table, and he said there's a chance that can happen. I hope that that is researched, and I hope we get our place at the table, and I hope you guys met with him when he was here, and if you did, good. And I hope he relayed the same information he did to me, because I was encouraged. Thank you.
Yeah, that's correct, Director Kuhn. Both Director Hanks and myself met with him the following day and recognized your discussions with him and interests, and they're exactly the same, like-minded as the board is, as Director Hanks and I were at that meeting. So we're moving forward and making efforts in that direction. That's all for board member comments. The general manager, do you have any comments, Kevin?
Yes, President Desert, members of the board, I too want to welcome Mr. Simmons as interim general counsel, and I want to thank Vance Taylor for so ably sitting in during this in-between time. So thank you to Mr. Taylor.
Legal counsel comments, Mr. Simmons.
No comments.
Okay, thank you. Okay, board, this takes us into the consent area of our agenda. We're looking at consent items 1 and consent items 3. Consent items 1 is the acknowledgement of director's expenses for the period ending February 25th, 2013. And consent item 3 is the approval of a statement of investments policy for 2013. These two items are located on page 4 and 16 of your agenda. Open for discussion or comments?
Mr. Chairman, I move both items.
I'll second it, since it's a consent agenda.
If it's what?
No room for discussion.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for that help.
Point of order.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second for consent items number 1 and 3. Call for the vote. So consent items 1 and 3 pass unanimously. We'll be discussing and handling consent item 2 under the action section of the agenda later on today. This takes us into the information area of the agenda. We have information item 4, page 24 of the agenda. This is the appearance by Colorado River Board Executive Officer Tanya Trujillo.
Hi, I'm Tina Shields, Colorado River Resources Manager. I today wanted to formally introduce you to Tanya Trujillo, the new executive director of the Colorado River Board of California. She has been down here before, but this is sort of her first official visit to you all as a new board. We've been touring her around our facilities and updating her as to our many issues on the river and more recent positions in regard to the Salton Sea and other actions. So I wanted to give her an opportunity to say hello to you if you have any questions for her. And then real quickly, before I do that, introduce also Mr. Hank Kuiper, who serves as the public representative on the Colorado River Board and is sort of another voice for our local community. So, Tanya?
Would you also want to introduce Mr. Kuiper, who is on the board as a community at-large rep?
Sure.
Do what?
Just want to introduce you.
So this is Mr. Hank Kuiper. He serves as the public representative on the Colorado River Board and was appointed by Governor Schwarzenegger. And he's still on. So he's been a good voice for the Valley to help honor our policies and our interests and make sure that we're not forgotten down here, in addition to Mr. Hanks, of course, who serves as the agency representative.
She's got mud on her shoes to prove
it. Oh, good.
Thank you, Tina, for the introduction, and good afternoon. My name is Tanya Trujillo. I am the new executive director for the Colorado River Board of California, taking the place of Jerry Zimmerman, who served in this capacity for approximately 25 years. And I appreciate the great mentoring that he provides to me as I'm getting my feet on the ground in this job. I do very much appreciate the touring that we had yesterday and today down in the district. Yesterday did saw the sights on the west side and this morning over on the east side, and it's an invaluable experience to get my feet dirty and get, you know, to see the actual flow situation and the irrigation practices that are so pervasive in this valley. The my personal background is I'm from New Mexico. I'm a lawyer by profession, but have worked with engineers and geologists and hydrologists for my entire career. The most recent experience I had in New Mexico was representing the state of New Mexico on interstate matters, including Colorado River matters. So I got to know a lot of the issues in the Colorado River Basin and a lot of the people that I work with now, but from California's perspective. The situation in California and within IID in general is of a scale that is tremendous. And as somebody who's coming in from another state, it is very impressive to see how much good is put to work with the water that the state of California receives. And IID is obviously the largest water user within California, and the scale is really, really impressive. I appreciate the experience of being down here and seeing how you guys do your business. The board, the Colorado River Board, was established in 1937, so it's been around for 75 years, and was established under state law in California with the specific job of representing the state vis-a-vis the other states on the Colorado River. So each of the other states has a representative, and in California, our board is that representative. I, as executive director, often, you know, can speak for California. But the job is interesting because in California, the water rights are owned by the individual members, not by the state. So my job is largely to try to find a common denominator and a common voice amongst the Colorado River water rights owners, including IID. And I fully appreciate the challenges associated with that, and that it's not always easy to make peace amongst some of the entities that have had, you know, long-standing disagreements. But I am very encouraged by my predecessors, Jerry Zimmerman's ability to do that and to interact well with the other states on behalf of California and try to serve the state of California and California's interests with respect to challenges that exist out there in the basin. I think one of currently the most serious challenges that we all face is hydrology. We're going into the 13th year of a serious drought. I think the past 2 years will go on record as being the driest in history, unless some, you know, magical storms appear this spring. But that situation weighs heavily on the minds of all of the states and is makes things tense at times, just because the water supply that we all rely on is not there. And we're trying to work together as much as possible to solve problems collectively with the other states under those circumstances. The board that we work with, that I work for, is comprised of three agricultural members. IID, Director Hanks is our member, and Director Benson is your alternate on our board, and appreciate their service with us. Palo Verde Irrigation District and Coachella have seats on the board from the agricultural side, and on the municipal side, we have Metropolitan Water District, San Diego County Water Authority, and the Los Angeles Water and Power. And in addition, we have two members of the public, and you're well represented on in that capacity, and then the Department of Natural Resources and the Department of Game and Fish, now Fish and Wildlife Service, serve as members of our board. So we have a very good, strong, well-balanced base of input that we receive to in order to make policy for the state and help us make decisions on the challenges that we all face. So I, again, very much appreciate the hospitality and the touring that the staff provided me yesterday and today. We've already made plans for the next visit, so I'm looking forward to being back again, and appreciate your board's participation on our board, and am happy to continue to help with any issues that are out there that may come up, as are the staff in my office and Jerry Zimmerman, our retired member as well. So I'm happy to be here, appreciate getting to see you all, and happy to answer questions or listen in for the remainder of the water section of the meeting. Thanks.
I would just like to add, appreciate you coming. And I would also like to inform this audience, do not be misled by her size or her soft voice. She is very capable in fulfilling the role that she has been placed in, has quite an experience behind her. In your visit, I hope that you were able to see firsthand some of the challenges that we're faced with the saline issue. I think sometimes in the interest of everybody looking at water and how can we can transfer or move this or that, they forget that the saline issue in the river ends up in the Salton Sea. And a lot of times it's seen by other agencies as our problem. And we're sure that will become a focus soon. Thank you for coming.
Director Benson.
I just wanted to thank you, Tanya, and I just wanted you to outline really quickly, if you could, the issues with other states and explain the relationship of Northern Basin, Southern Basin. Some of the people in the audience might not understand how the compact works as well.
Absolutely. Appreciate that opportunity. The Colorado River Compact was signed in 1922, and I promise I won't go through hours and hours of the background, but there are seven basin states, and in general, the basins are divided by the upper basin and the lower basin. In the upper basin are Colorado, Utah, Wyoming, and New Mexico. In the lower basin is California, Arizona, and Nevada. And the general allocation is, you know, 50-50. Half of the water is allocated to the northern upper basin states and half to the lower basin states. The lower basin receives an additional apportionment associated with tributary uses. And then in addition, we also serve Mexico pursuant to a treaty that was entered into in 1944. So there's 1.5 million acre feet that the U.S. delivers to Mexico off of the Colorado River. The tensions between the states or and among the states, I think, have existed since the compact was signed in 1922, and the water development that has occurred has always resulted in additional tensions amongst the states. When the lower basin, you know, was growing and using water more quickly than the upper basin states, they were automatically nervous about that, and that's going back for decades. Even today, you know, the upper basin still has room for more growth in terms of their compact entitlements, but every additional acre foot of water that they develop means us in the lower basin get nervous because, well, that means they might not be delivering water down to us that we, you know, are looking forward to and have been relying on. So that even though they're entitled to more development, there's a tension there that always exists. Similarly, from the upper basin's perspective, they're always very closely watching all of the water uses in the lower basin and tracking very carefully our water uses to see, are we staying within our apportionments? Are we improperly using water in one way or the other? Because of that basic tension in terms of, you know, maintaining the balance of the water supply versus the water allocations. The states have recognized that fighting about those issues is an option, but not necessarily the best solution. So we have tried to find common solutions and tried to work together to solve problems as opposed to fighting about them. In 2003, the lower basin states got together on some water allocation and water sharing agreements that were rolled into larger agreements amongst the full basin, such that through the allocations in Lake Powell and Lake Mead, we can better balance the water supplies between the two basins and really try to avoid conflict in the future if we can. So there's a long list of ways that we can fight with other states about issues, but there's also a long list of ways that we can try to work together and develop additional supplies or better use the water supplies that exist in the region as well.
Thank you, Tanya. I wanted to also thank you for making your time available to come out and visit, not just for one day. You're here for 2 days. Saw our facilities and the ag industry in the Imperial Valley from the east side to the west side. Mm-hmm. And I look forward to being able to visit with you on some kind of a tour in the near future myself and visit with you in person the next time you're in town. Any other questions for Tanya? Thank you, Tanya.
Thanks. Thank you very much.
Okay, we're up to information item 5, page 25 of the agenda. This is Water Department General Matters. Mr. Silva.
Good afternoon, Mr. President. Both items I had have been discussed by the board members regarding the Water Conservation Committee. The only other thing I have is the water use continues to be hovering around where we should be at this point in time. We'll see what happens as we start. The high water flows are just starting now, so we'll watch it real close and report to you. That's all I've got.
I had a question, sir.
Okay, Mr. Benson.
I have a question related to the on-farm, what the timeline for that is. I have a number of people calling me and crops that are actually already finishing that thought they could be signed up, and they don't know if there's ability to still apply for those.
Today we just heard that we are getting the contract so that we can start talking to them, but it's probably going to be another week before we can actually show them actual contracts. So, and the board wanted to see them as well, so we're probably more than a week away from being able to do that.
Okay. And then the implementation of the System 1A, that was discussed last meeting.
Yes.
Is that going forward, or are you going to bring it back to the board for discussion?
We will bring it back to the board. We plan to have some kind of a workshop. We talked about it at the next board meeting or after the next board meeting, maybe in the afternoon, to have that workshop and present that portion of the work plus the plans for the future.
Okay. And then I think at Farm Bureau yesterday, there was some discussion that through TruePoint, they've been able to isolate each crop and the water used by crop on a general basis, so it's not particular farms, but you know, it's relevant to a lot of people looking for crop choices with limited water supply, if that can be discussed with the public as soon as possible.
Yeah, that was something that came out of the Water Conservation Committee request, and so Carlos and the guys have been working on that, and of course there's variability on that as well, but we do have the, we're close to getting those numbers, and we were going to share it with that committee, so we can have it available. Yes.
Well, even if you can send it out ahead of the next meeting for discussion, because I think that people need to see things before the meeting so they have time to analyze it.
So that workshop on Phase 1A would occur at your next board meeting, which is April 2nd.
Mr. Silva, also there was a Water Conservation Committee meeting discussing allocation and farm unit fallowing that took place last week. Were we going to get a little bit of an update on that, on some of those dates and numbers and times that are going to be presented at the further at the workshops later this week?
Yeah, when all the information that we have today will be presented at the meeting starting tomorrow. Yes.
Okay.
The only thing that we have for sure again is that the committee did approve a May 1st starting date. I think it was reported by Director Benson, and that that it ends at the end of the year. We are still talking about the number itself. We were talking about maybe increasing the amount of acre feet per acre slightly, finding some water for that. So those are the only two things that we have for sure. We're still discussing all kinds of other details that will have to be worked out yet. So at those meetings with the farmers, excuse me, the biggest thing we're trying to do is just to let them know that it is happening, it's going to start, but we don't have all of the details. And so we just want to make sure everybody understands that it is going to happen. That's the biggest item we're trying to get across, because we don't have all of the details yet.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Silva. Any other questions for Mr. Silva?
I would just like to add, you know, the definite plan was passed several years ago. There's been amendments, a lot of changes, and I think the staff is still moving along with that plan. When we have that review, I think there probably needs to be some type of confirmation whether this board is still in agreement with it in light of the changes in revenue flows and priorities, I think.
Well, that's the way we want to have that workshop and get direction from the board on kind of proceeding. I look at it as that we've got some projects to implement. We've got some design work, and then we have some planning to do of how we're going to keep going to the future. Yes, we'll present that information in that format to you.
I think some of the presentation that the CFO will be given on number 7 might add a little light on it, too. Okay. Thank you, Jesse.
Anything else for Mr. Silva?
I think just for the public, the apportionment's a big deal for farming. Everyone understands that. But the hang-up comes in the water exchange and how the water does get exchanged, who manages that. So we welcome everybody's comments at these public sessions. And I've heard a lot of different theories on how it should be done. And we are working with the Water Conservation Committee to come up with a farmer approach, since they're the ones that are trading the water amongst themselves. The ID technically doesn't use the water, they just deliver the water. So it is important to get buy-in from all the users as well. So please attend the public forums.
On that regard, yes, we're working with the Farm Bureau to get some people involved from our side to work with them to come up with the whatever plan they want to implement, so that we can be prepared working with them, so that we don't lose any time once the implementation begins.
Thank you, Mr. Silva. Next up, information item 6 is the monthly update by Al Kalin, chairman of the Water Conservation Advisory Board, on issues discussed at its March 14th, 2013 meeting. This is page 26 of the agenda.
Good afternoon. Al Kalin, Westmoreland. The Water Conservation Advisory Board met last Thursday, March 14th. We had a short meeting because the Water Conservation Committee were waiting to meet right after our meeting, so we cut our usual hour and a half time down to 45 minutes and removed a few items from the agenda, which we will take up at the next meeting. The one item we did discuss was the System Conservation Program update, and Josh Scott is in charge of that, and he gave a PowerPoint presentation. Currently, you're in Phase 1A, and that consists of a SCADA upgrade, delivery measurement, spill monitoring, and automated headings, and those are items that you, the board, have already approved. Requests for proposals were sent out, and the chosen vendor award will be announced this coming week, I believe, with notice to proceed likely in May. The staff is currently looking at some other system conservation programs that might be very beneficial, which would include numerous lateral interties, where you can hook one canal to another, and a reservoir on the west side main, somewhere around the trifolium 13 heading. They believe that would be very beneficial. They're planning it would store perhaps 100 to 300 acre feet of water. This is something that you have not approved yet. They're just studying it. Other projects that they're looking at is perhaps lining portions of a main canal to stop seepage. And perhaps some interceptors. We discussed these items during the meeting. The lateral interceptors, interties, are estimated to conserve 10,000 acre feet, some which have been metering devices installed, and some of them don't. The WCAB members seem to be divided and voice their concerns on going forth with the lateral interties while the looming apportionment endeavor hangs in the rafters, more or less. Others stated that because of the looming apportionment, the interties are necessary due to certain activities on the laterals, like feedlots and dairies. It'll still be necessary for some spill in some of the laterals. We also heard a presentation from Teresita Perez on a breakdown of the transferred waters with respect to the incomes. Mrs. Perez provided a handout with water and financial analysis and said that if we wanted, she could also provide a cost sheet analysis that there were some questions about. It appeared that all the water, transfer water incomes up to date have averaged $316 an acre foot. We also heard a presentation from Darren Fillmore on-farm conservation updates. As Mr. Silva talked about just a few minutes ago, the contracts have not yet gone out yet, but hopefully they will soon. And as a final measure, we created a subcommittee to evaluate the existing automated gates. And that was about it for the meeting. The next meeting will be on April 11th.
Al, on the $316 an acre foot average, who did you say you got that number from?
It came from Teresita Perez.
Water. Teresa.
Do you know whether that included the transfer water out of the All-American Canal?
No, I don't. I don't have that
okay.
paper in front of me to see.
I'll backtrack and see. Okay.
Al, I had a question, and I don't know if you've seen, but there was a memo done on reviewing the history of the gates. Was that made available to the WCAB? Can that be shared with the subcommittee?
No, I know Jesse and I talked about where you have currently the way that the water billing works. You could have one delivery gate that irrigates multiple fields, which could be the same crop or different crops. Where there are different crops, that water is separated. But where it's the same crop, like two crops of wheat or alfalfa or sugar beets or whatever, it's not separated and it's creating a problem. And so we've discussed how we can separate those two fields that are irrigated off the same delivery.
Yeah, this is the automated gates that have been used in the main canals. It just went through a chronological history of how those gates were incorporated into the system. So.
We did not give that report to Al, but we need to give them to that subcommittee so okay. they can look at that.
Just want to make sure that got to them. Thanks.
Any other questions for Al? Thank you, Mr. Kalin.
Thank you.
Next up, we're on information item 7, the overview of the water transfer iBank loan guarantee. By Chief Financial Officer Greg Broking, page 27 of your agenda.
Just a little background on who is the iBank. We use that as an abbreviated term, but its full name is California Infrastructure and Economic Development Bank.
Greg, can you move your microphone a little, please?
Can you hear me better now?
A little bit closer.
Can you hear me now?
No.
No? You can't hear me?
Talk like you're mad at us.
You not here at all?
Yeah, I can hear that.
Oh, okay.
There's kind of a...
Well, I'll just hold it and hopefully I can...
Over here.
Yeah.
And it might be something to do with age, but...
The California Infrastructure and Economic Development Bank is part of state government. As I said earlier, we referred to it as the iBank. It was created in 1994 to finance public infrastructure and also private development. It can issue tax-exempt and taxable bonds. However, the agreement they have with us is to provide a credit enhancement or provide a guarantee. And I'll get into those details a little more in the next few slides. The iBank is obligated to provide a loan guarantee for the district for district debt issued for the purpose of completing the water transfer system conservation projects. The state or the iBank has established a trust account, a reserve account for us, and they've put in I don't know what they put in originally, but with interest, it's a little over $24 million. So that's, this is my term, it's not a legal term, it's their good faith effort to show that they plan to make good on their guarantee. So they put money into account, into a trust account for that guarantee, although the actual formal guarantee will not be in place until we actually issue bonds for the project. There is protection to IID and investors by requiring the iBank to seek a state appropriation to pay the debt service payments on the IID debt. What I call a state guarantee, but it's an appropriation credit guarantee. Those are rated lower than just a flat out state guarantee. And so what they, this was back in 2003, what the iBank guaranteed for the district was net proceeds of $150 million in 2003 dollars. And so obviously, since we haven't implemented that program yet, where we haven't issued bonds that have been guaranteed by the state. That number has been escalated over the years, and what we're estimating it to be now is in 2013 dollars of $216 million. So if you add the $50 million that we've received from the Water Authority, we're pretty close based on and I know the programs are still being updated. That gives us about $266 million that has very little risk to the district, because the $50 million has been given by the Water Authority for conservation projects, and all we're really required to do to keep that money is spend it on conservation projects. Mm-hmm. And if the same thing with the state, we have a guarantee of from them, providing we invest in water system conservation projects. And some of the details regarding the bonds, they have to be no more than 30 years from the date of issuance, bear a fixed interest rate, and structured with level debt service. And since I've been here on the other issues that we've had, primarily on the energy side, that has been the same guidelines that we have followed: 30-year bonds, fixed interest rate, and level debt service. So the state guarantee kicks in if one of three events occurs. That's the termination of the transfer on or before August 3rd, 2048 for any reason other than the two listed below. And the two listed below are default under the transfer by the San Diego County Water Authority, or a court or administrative body takes actions that results in reduction or elimination of transfer revenues. So if that was to occur and the contract would be in default or be terminated, this would be the process that we would go through to get the debt service to be paid for the remaining life of the bonds. And so the first year's payment or debt service would be funded through the debt service reserve fund. So when we issue bonds, one of the requirements that we're going to have is set aside a year's payment for debt service and this level debt service. So the maximum payment for a year will be the same as the average, more than likely. So we have to have money set aside for that. And the second year's debt service payment would be paid by the district. And so what I've talked about previously is what we're going to attempt to do, and we think we'll be able to do it when we get around to issuing the bonds, is to only pledge the water transfer revenue for these bonds, so that the water, what I call the water delivery system, will not be on the hook for any of this debt. It will only be transfer revenue. And so that is our plan, and one that we will be pushing when it gets time to issue the bonds. And so that second year's debt service payment would need to come out of transfer revenue, not delivery system revenue. And then thereafter, the IBANC would be obligated to make debt service payments. The district would be off the hook, and the state would have to step up.
That would have to happen once a triggering event occurs, or just IID going through the normal action of paying down the bonds and then a trigger event happens?
No, triggering event would have to occur, and then once that occurs, then we go through this process of continuing to pay the debt service. So with just like any other bond issue, the IID's board of directors will need to approve it. They will need to approve the loan guarantee along with the IBANC. They will also need to approve it. So we've started the process with the IBANC. We're in very early stages, but what we're envisioning is to get the IBANC involved in the process in day one, and get them comfortable with what we're doing so that when it's time for the iBank to take it to their board, they will be ready and willing and able to answer any questions that their board may have. So the first step of the process is to select your underwriting team. And we sent out an underwriting RFP last week. I think we've given them 4 weeks to respond, and thereafter we'll go through those responses and pick a financing team for these projects. We'd actually done this once before back in 2009 or 10, but so much time has passed since then, and changes within the industry, we thought it would be better to go out again and see what kind of responses we get. So we've received some comments from the iBank on our RFP. We sent that to them for their comments, so they know what was going on. And we did receive some, and along with some internal comments, and then we've sent that out, and we're waiting for responses. Our plan is to involve the iBank in any, when we get ready to finance, in all our financing meetings, so they'll be invited to sit in with us. They're not going to be invited to vote or anything, but they can certainly provide their input and opinion, and we'll take it under consideration. And so they will also be given the opportunity to review the proposed system conservation projects. And that is one thing that they will have to get comfortable with. I don't view it as that big of an issue, but it is part of the agreement that they have to sign off and confirm that what we say is a water system conservation project is in fact what they think is a water system conservation project. And I think their plan is to use Department of Water Resources personnel to review those projects. So we're just trying to get ready so that when the plan is developed and Jesse and the board say go, we're ready to provide the assistance that you need.
Questions, board?
Yeah, I'd just like to make a couple of comments. I asked for this agenda item to be on there for a couple of reasons. One, I think the timing is now, it's much more mature than it was in 2009, 2010 when we looked at it. But two main ideas of the use of the iBank. One is to lower the risk or possible impacts on the ratepayers in the event that something happens, shortage on the river or whatever impacts the flow of the revenue. And then the other, it can get us out or reduce the fouling much sooner. The fouling program is having a drastic impact on our county. And I'd like to see us move out of that. A couple of questions. What would be the difference and the interest points of this guarantee, going a guaranteed loan versus a tax-exempt loan?
Well, we'll have that information for you when we bring it back to you, because it'll change over time. And there could be a difference. There could be a difference by using the guarantee or not using the guarantee. Back in 2009 and 10, when the state's credit rating was really low, it economically it probably didn't make any sense to take their guarantee because it was going to cost more money with it. But as the state's rating has moved up the scale, so to speak, it may be a different answer right now. And so when we get closer to that point, we will certainly provide you with what we think the market is under each of those conditions.
So you will analyze that for us then and give your recommendation?
Yes.
Okay. Also, what is the difference between the iBank and the NAD Bank? Yeah, I've seen both terms used in the QSA, and I was a little confused between the two.
Well, I think the NAD Bank stands for North America Development Bank, and it's my understanding that's federally funded. The monies for those projects come from the federal government.
Is that
wrong on that.
Is that an option that's also available to us?
Not for a guaranteed loan, no, because the NAD bank would want you to, unless it was a grant, you would have to pay it back.
Okay. I would I would think that we would should be looking at revenue flows. I would say revenue flows not related to water sales. And in this case, it might be our geothermal assets and resources and potential of developing those on the sea, so that all conservation projects that we undertake minimizes the risk to the ratepayer. And I would ask you to look and see what type of debt service that would cover as far as on the principle of an additional loan if necessary. Somewhere along the line, but when we start on farm, we'll probably be looking at an additional loan.
We can look into that for the geothermal resources.
Thank you.
Director Hanks, there might be some additional models out there that are being contemplated that will also have revenue streams, and perhaps we should meet with Mr. Brokin to talk about those. Mr. Brokin, you've done upwards of $300-400 million in bonding and financing here at the IID.
Yeah, I would say that's true, yes.
And with that experience there and doing that, we've used bond counsel to go out and get those things accomplished, but in addition to our own talented staff that we have here to get this accomplished. With the iBank and your review of the how it works and who's in play here and the requirements, do you see any potential hiccups there when we start to go forward with this or something that may slow down the process that we aren't adequately prepared for now that we need to get prepared for?
Well, I think we're as prepared as we can get. I mean, we are going to be dealing with the state, and we've had some issues with them in the past as to what their guarantee was. But it's my belief, based on legislation that was passed a year or two back and some discussions with iBank personnel, that we've resolved all those issues. But the only way to know for sure is when we start the process and see how long it takes.
And once again, your presentation shows there's a balance in the iBank of $24,210,000. That amount, but the actual amount that we're talking about going out and utilizing is upwards of $216 million of bonding.
Yes, they've set aside probably roughly 2 years worth of debt service, and so the general fund's perspective up at the state, they have, if something was to blow up, they're looking at having 4 years to resolve the problem before the state has to make the appropriation, because again, the debt service reserve fund would pay the first year,
right.
The district would pay the second year, and then the monies that had already been set aside would probably pay 3 and 4 years and maybe into the fifth year.
And those monies we're talking about right now are the $24 million on page 3 of your presentation.
Right. And so they would, from their perspective, they would have something, they would have that amount of time to try to, you know, fix whatever was broken in the agreement.
So it's important to note that some people get a little confused when they look at this. They think that that's the dollar amount that we can borrow or go out and take out of that account. No, in fact, that's actually set there to do debt service for a couple of years. Worst case scenario, until the state does an appropriation to make up their guarantee portion. Total dollar amount we're talking about in doing projects is more upwards of, in 2013 dollars, of $216 million.
Yeah, roughly that's what we think we could borrow under the agreement.
Right.
Or the net proceeds under the agreement, which is a little different. We'd actually borrow more than that amount. When they say net proceeds, expenses in the debt service reserve fund that we would need to fund would come out before, so we'd add those totals to the number. Mm-hmm. So we might borrow $240 million. And have net proceeds to spend on projects of the 216.
I'd like to throw back out there again the need for cost benefits on these projects. I know that's been an issue, and it's been told that you can't do a cost-benefit analysis, and I don't buy it. I think in moving forward with a loan like that, it's very important that we produce the most water and the, gain the best revenue flow we can to help finance future projects. We had $50 million upfront money, and I think $25 million is kind of going for hardware. You know, and hopefully somewhere in that process they can conserve water. I'm not quite sure. But in a project, for example, I'll just use the Highline Canal. If that generates, say, 60,000 acre feet, that is an annual income. The debt service off of that would be probably maybe 25, at the most 30% of the funds that it's generating. So it would give us a cash flow for our other projects. And it really needs to be synchronized between the CFO's office and the water department so we can maximize these dollars.
Well, yes, I agree with you. I think all these projects, when they're finally chosen, will show water savings, or I would imagine they wouldn't go forward. So once we get the water savings in acre feet, we can do the cost-benefit analysis of what the net impact is to the district.
Greg, I have a question for you. You gave a presentation back on November 13th. I'm going back in time. I think the total projects at that time is $256 million in system capital projects. And then I don't know how that's changed over time, but it seems like we're always really close to that $240, $230 million, because I think this called out for, of the $50 million, $27 was used already through 2013. The remainder is going to be used going forward, and then 2014, you have 120, 2016, you have 106. And I don't know that the plan's changed all that much, but what is the timeline for spending this money? And what's the payback? Because we have to align the payments on the water transfer with the length of the QSA. It's, the document ends in so many years, we can't go past that period, right?
Right. And we don't plan on it because it goes to 2047, I think.
Right.
And so as long as we borrow, we don't have to use 30 years. We just can't exceed 30 years.
Okay.
So we can still use 30-year debt service up till 2017. And right now we expect to have all those projects done by 2017.
Okay.
Just remind everybody that the San Diego agreement does not permit fouling past 2017. That kind of gives you a timeline.
Right.
For Greg?
I'll just add right now, I will not support fouling beyond 2017.
Well, I have one quick question, but is there a cost to the ID for the iBank or no? It's paid for by the state.
There is a cost as part of the settlement. We're going to pay them, and they're going to document expenses, 1% of what we borrow as an expense to monitor our contract. So they're going to have some expenses up front, because they're going to have to hire consultants to confirm, you know, that the water system conservation projects are in fact water system conservation projects, and they're also going to hire a financial advisor to advise them on this transaction.
So that's 1% up front or annually?
We thought it would be more like 1% annually, but they've kind of asked if because they know they're going to have expenses up front, if they can kind of get an advance on some of those, and I don't see any reason why, as long as they can document the expenses.
Okay.
Which they should be able to do. But the original agreement said they could be reimbursed for their expenses, and we negotiated the 1% as part of this last settlement.
My other understanding was that if there was a court proceeding that caused the transfer to stop, that the iBank was in place, but you just said that that is not the case, right?
It's only in place if we borrow, if they guarantee the money that we borrow for the water system conservation projects. Until we issue those bonds, build the projects, yes, the guarantee is not in place.
So it's one of three triggering events. Any of those would trigger it?
Yes.
Okay. All right, gotcha.
Providing we've already borrowed the money and have their guarantee.
Right.
If those things happen beforehand, then the state's not on the hook.
Okay, any other questions for Greg?
I would just expect all these costs that you're talking about would be weighed against the risk in your recommendation to us.
They will be.
Thank you, Mr. Broeking. Next up is information item 8, Energy Department General Matters, page 33 of the agenda. Mr. Stills.
Yes, Mr. President. I, too, wanted to report that we had spent a lot of time at the Renewable Summit last week, and I think it was a success. I think Mr. Kelly's group and his economic development group did a wonderful job. I also want to compliment IID's team that was working out there. I think Rosa Maria Gonzalez and the Susie Carrillo and the girls in the booth did a wonderful job supporting that. I thought Mrs. Shields and Mr. Wilcox gave very informative presentations out there, and I thought there were a number of presentations that hit on a interesting theme that we need to be cognizant of, and one, that the Cal ISO market is closing for renewables. Two, that in securing their renewables, the Cal ISO members secured them according to RPS and without really looking at system stability, and that this has created a potentially unstable system on the Cal ISO's grid that projected ramp swings are going to be somewhere in the 17,000 megawatts over a three-hour period of time, which is driving another issue as an energy imbalance market. And the energy imbalance market is coming. FERC is looking at it right now. They're actually realizing it's going to be needed to stabilize this grid. And so we're going to see energy imbalance probably in the near future. And again, transmission to cure that imbalance will be the key. So we'll need to keep an eye on that. While at the summit, we had a number of meetings that were very positive. The general manager, myself, and Mr. Nahai met with Chairman Weissmuller of the CPUC and had a very productive meeting trying to get in sync.
CEC.
And then we met with CPUC's Commissioner Carla Peterman and the Governor's Office Representative Michael Picker and had very, very positive feedback from them. In the meeting with the CEC Chairman, Weissmuller, we did bring up the parasitic load issue. And we were informed that they were looking at their handbook. We needed to get a definition into the guidebook for the definition of station service. He said the meeting was going to be last Friday. When we checked on that meeting, it was actually Thursday, so we didn't have time to get somebody to the meeting. But we have found out that we will be on the copy list. We will be editing and getting our comments into that guidebook so we can set the stage for that definition and maybe push back on that parasitic load. The next issue is the back feed station service. I've talked about this before. We should get a performance contract for the back feed this evening. Once I have that, I will be sending that out to the developers for comments, so that'll probably be tomorrow. And along that line, in Campo Verde, we've ran into a snag at the Campo Verde Gentai agreement. And that snag is ownership from the fence line in of that Gentai agreement. Initially, when we talked with Campo Verde and brought that Gentai term sheet to the board. We had talked with San Diego. San Diego said there would be no problems getting that ownership from the fence line in, and they would amend the LGIA. When we got down a couple weeks ago, they started balking at that. So we've had a series of negotiations going on. I just got an email that I'm supposedly going to get a letter curing that tomorrow, but I'll wait and see what it says, because without that ownership from the fence line into the bus, it could create problems and bypass for us, and I couldn't recommend that going forward. San Diego knows that this has to be solved before we can move that Gentile on. The other item that I'd like to bring to your attention is we had a fire in a line truck in La Quinta last night. It was, the line truck was recycling the exhaust environmental canister. It's a retrofit on these line trucks to bring them into compliance with CARB requirements and EPA. And a lot of your older line trucks have these on there. And they're looking to see whether they believe that retrofit actually created the fire, but it did extensive damage to the line truck, which goes back to the issue of we've got a lot of older line trucks, and we need to get a replacement program in place so that we can bring those up to speed. So I think, okay, Jesse just informed me that they had the same type of issue on a water truck prior to this, and it was retrofitted
4 months ago, yeah.
So this may be a little bit of a common practice. It might be something that we have to look at with our heavy equipment coming down the road. How do we get them in compliance without losing the equipment? If this retrofit isn't going to work, if it's going to create a problem for us, then we probably should start those replacement cycles pretty soon.
Is there any liability, responsibility on the side of the retrofit supplier or manufacturer?
I don't have that information. I'll have to talk with Mr. Campbell and get further information on this. We were just informed this morning of this issue.
So they plug them into an electrical source and then they regenerate, they bake?
They regenerate and get them ready, and they're tied to the ignition switch. They can't start the ignition until they're
and clear. Are these being plug-ins being done inside a garage area that encompasses a great dollar amount of equipment?
Or are
we doing it outside?
They plug them in, let them run until they're clean. So it may be creating a problem. We need to look at that a little bit deeper and see what we have to do to fix that. Also, we lost the Calipatria prison for 4 hours yesterday. We had a bird fly into a line on one of the D1s on the P-54. It was out about 4 hours, but it's back and fixed. So, one more thing. I received the first draft of the first 107 pages of the IRP this morning. We probably have a series of iterations to go on that, maybe three or four more. It's probably about two-thirds done. So between now and the middle of next week, we're going to be bringing that IRP forward. Okay.
Any other questions for Carl?
Thank you, Carl.
Carl, your IRP, that's the projection looking forward for rates and transmission?
Correct. It's going to be looking for, it's our integrated resource plan for the next 20 years, looking at what we have to do, what generators, what transmission lines we have to, what regulatory issues are going to be impact us, and how we're going to move forward. So it'll be our overall plan. If you want, I can keep you posted on this draft if you want to read it as it goes. So there are probably about another 50 pages to go, and there's going to be edits ongoing in this for next month.
Okay.
Any other questions for Carl?
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Carl. This brings us up to our last information item.
Hang on, Jesse just informed me that George Sanabria has had a heart attack. George Sanabria.
He's one of our. He's one of your.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So, I just heard that, so I don't have any more information on that.
Okay. He's climbing the pole to meet the training.
This takes us to information item 9, a review of the generator interconnection agreement with Soul Orchard, San Diego State University facility, page 34 of your agenda. Who's Carl, are you presenting on this today?
Well, yeah. Jamie has had a family crisis, so she's asked me to.
As the board's aware, we have a PPA with Soul Orchard for 3 to 5 megawatts of energy in a community solar project with San Diego State in place. Soul Orchard did apply in their interconnection agreement for a 7 megawatt evaluation for the interconnection. So this interconnection was processed on 7 megawatts. They submitted the interconnection request in February of 2012. They were interconnecting to the IID system via the tap to the 34 kV line, the BH line between Alamarillo and Hopeville substation. The project didn't go through. It was serial analyzed to determine impacts on the reliability of the system, and it didn't really go through our OAT system. It went to the distribution side because of the low megawatts that they were actually looking at. There was a system impact study and a facility study, and the total interconnection costs are $1.256 million. Now, in this PPA, IID will take generation from the project to facilitate the community solar project concept, and the customers can choose to participate. So they're being served with green energy. Soul Orchard has a responsibility in that process to try to sell that. IID is backstopping this community project, that if they can't sell the green energy to customers out there, that we will take it at a set price. The problem that we have is under the provisions of a separate power purchase agreement, which was done prior to my being here, they had capped the interconnection cost at $600,000. You remember these, and then there's terms in there that developers to be reimbursed for all costs over the cap in 5 equal installments at 2% interest. And that amount is $656,000. I will just tell you this, and it comes out a little later in this presentation. When I looked at this, I have since asked my staff what happened. Apparently, the previous energy manager is the one that went with the cap. Nobody can figure out what his basis for the cap was. But I've issued a directive to my staff to all PPAs in the future, the cap or the risk of interconnection goes through the developer. So these PPAs won't see caps coming in the future. So anyway, IID is on the hook for a portion of that $656,000 that we'll have to pay to move this forward. The interconnection agreement is our pro forma agreement. It's an aggressive in-service date for first quarter 2014. The customer desires to assume responsibility for procurement to drive the schedule. They can actually purchase things faster than we can in order to get them here. And it's not eligible since it went through the distribution process and not being processed through OAT. It's not eligible for transmission credit rate credits. The site location, oh, that's hard to see. You can see the, I don't have a, this doesn't work. It's just to the east of the Brawley-San Diego State campus. That will work. Here's the San Diego State campus here, and the project is just in the fields to the east of that. This is Highway 98 running here. The Alamrio sub is down in this area over here. With that, this is, except for the interconnection cost, this is a fairly standard generation interconnection agreement, and we will look at those interconnection costs. There is one other thing that we have. Some of those may be categorized interconnection costs. Some may be system reliability cost, which we could recover. We're going to be drilling down on that a little bit to see which solar should pay and which we should pay. But it's a pretty broad definition in the PPA, so it's a contractual obligation. We need to move this forward. Any questions?
I have a question related to Wheeling. The PPA that we have is how much, and then the above and beyond that would be subject to Wheeling, I assume?
Well, I don't think there's any Wheeling provisions on here. I think it's a community solar, and we're allowing them to solicit across our lines.
Okay.
I don't know if they've really had any responses on the community solar. I would envision if they don't do that, we're probably just going to be buying this into our system and using it as part of our resource cost.
And then it would be subject to the initial PPA plus the additional power. If they go forward with more power, would be a feed-in tariff? Or
We'd have to look at that. I mean, that's something that we'd have to discuss with the board.
Okay.
If they go forward with the other two, then we'll have to talk about that.
There's no third-party provisions in this contract, is there?
No.
Okay. Have the surrounding neighbors been notified of the landscape changes? I know that was an issue. The first project we looked at with a 40-foot tall...
I will have to get that information for you. I'll have to get with the project management group and find out what's been done on that.
They would have been notified through the planning department.
It would have been planning
the
environmental.
That was an issue. Will there be additional lines going in?
I don't think so. I think this is cleared out to handle the 7 megawatts, so...
Yeah, okay. And what about the water? That ground's currently in a crop, if I remember right.
I will have to check on the water issue. I don't know if the water... I think on all of these PPAs, I think that we require that they get with the water department and establish a water contract. And I don't know if that's been done yet.
Okay.
Good afternoon. I'm Will Pritchard, Vice President with SolarChard. So to answer some of the questions about the project specifics, this project is located on San Diego State University land. It's part of their Brawley campus, part of the technology park for that campus. So the ground that is being built on is already within the master plan footprint for the college campus. And in terms of the line work for the interconnection, there is a half mile between the campus and the nearest corner of that BH line, where we'll be overbuilding an existing 12 kV line with a 34.5 kV line. So there's a existing right-of-way, existing pole line, but the overbuild is required for that half mile to reach the BH line where it is now.
Is that currently in a crop? Is it in Bermuda grass?
It's a grass crop right now.
So there may be, you may need to look at the water issue still, even though it's in a master plan. If it has access to water, we need to make sure we have that covered.
As I said, most of the PPA, in fact, all the PPAs to get their water for this project, they will have to enter into a water contract with the water department, and there's standard provisions in our PPAs to do that.
That's all the questions I have.
Carl, the additional $656,000, could you give us a little more background on that? Is it a substation? Is it a different gauge of wire that we're upgrading, or what are the costs?
Well, you know, I'm not sure what my predecessor was looking at. I was thinking from conversations that he thought he was just going to be able to go into a lower level distribution circuit and tap into it. And it actually required that he go up to a 34.5 circuit and tap in, which increased the cost.
Does that qualify for any of our public benefit funds?
Very well could fall under the public benefit. We do have a category in AB 1890 that allows public benefits to handle this type of a project.
Yeah. Very good. Thank you, Carl. Okay, that takes us into the action items area of the agenda. First action item in this section will be the consent item number 2 that was pulled.
Can we take a 5-minute break?
We'll take a 5-minute break. We'll be back here at 10-minute break. We'll be back here at 5 minutes to 3:00.